This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Sports Files is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
So two pastors and a rabbi walk into Sports Files. No, really, it's happening on the show tonight. Earlier this season, before the horrifying news emerged, Penn State defeated Illinois in football, and a Methodist minister named Eric Schaefer incorporated the game into his sermon the next day. "My son Kyle and I were there," he said. "As Kyle and I were walking out of the stadium, I said, that was just a football game with 70,000 people. Can you imagine what heaven's going to be like?" Well, whatever your personal conception of heaven, I think we can say it won't necessarily resemble the Penn State football program. And yet, I get it. I understand why a football fan would make the comparison. Reverend Schaefer wasn't the first to note the similarities between sports and religion. He certainly won't be the last. Our ballparks are our cathedrals. We make pilgrimages to our favorite stadiums. We hold our breath when someone throws a Hail Mary. We know that touchdown Jesus can be found at Notre Dame. It's not all linguistics either. Sports brings us together, binds us in real community. The 9/11 memorial service was held at Yankee Stadium, after all. And yet at moments like these, after stories like Penn State, it's impossible not to wonder whether we're worshiping at the wrong place. Is it appropriate to invest so much money and emotional energy in sports? Can we reconcile our lives as fans with our lives of faith? Was it moral to spend $250 million to build FedEx Forum? How do we justify paying Houston Nutt $6 million just to go away? And how have we gotten to a place where there was a man holding a sign at Penn State the other day that said, and I really am not making this up, two of my favorite Jays in life, Jesus and Joe Pa? Tonight, we're going to tackle this tricky topic with the help of three men. Reverend Scott Morris is the founder of the Church Health Center. Micah Greenstein is the senior rabbi at Temple Israel. And Keith Norman is the senior pastor at First Baptist in Binghamton. All three are big sports fans, by the way. Coming up, I'll ask them to help me make sense of it all. Well, I have a particularly distinguished panel with me today, and I will introduce them. Keith Norman, who is the pastor at First Baptist Church, Broad Street.
Yes.
Scott Morris, executive director of the Church Health Center, also an associate pastor at St. John's. And Micah Greenstein, who's the senior rabbi at Temple Israel. So before we do anything else, let me establish your sports bona fides, and we'll start because Scott will insist that we talk about this at some point. So Scott, let's hear about your no-hitter.
My no-hitter. It was many years ago. I was in the ninth grade, and I pitched a no-hitter against Georgia Tech. Now you might.
Is it the real Georgia Tech?
The real Georgia Tech. It was an exhibition game. It was early in the spring. Our high school played Georgia Tech back in the late 60s, and it's crazy that we did. We were going to get killed anyway. Why not put the ninth grader out there? So they did, and there were probably 10 balls hit to the wall, but they were all caught. And
I joke about it. You, yeah, of course, would not have insisted we talk about it. Was that important to your life?
It was the highlight of my sports career.
I mean, when you think about it, do you just laugh about it now, or was it truly, I mean, is it something that is of lasting significance, gave you confidence or all that stuff?
That's interesting, Geoff. It actually probably did give me confidence, and in a way that I knew that I could compete on a sports level. It's allowed me to feel in my real life that, what I do is of value and that I have at least some talent, or right, did at one point.
All right, Micah. Micah Greenstein runs, you ran marathons, you used to play tennis. You used to play tennis, is that right?
Yeah, I actually was on scholarship in the seventh grade at the Bowl School in Jacksonville, Florida for tennis.
Wow!
It was big time.
A tennis scholarship in seventh grade?
In Florida.
In Florida?
I was in doubles, top 20 for the 10 and unders.
Man!
The problem was when
you were 15?
Yeah, when I hit the eighth grade. Yeah. Exactly. And I was good enough to ride that to seventh grade. But the scholarship was not renewed the eighth grade year. because the players in the seventh grade behind me were better.
You had a scholarship stripped away from you between seventh and eighth grade.
Basically, and then I went to public school, and it all turned out well.
That's a staggering story, and now you run marathons. And you...
Hence, that's why he's a rabbi now, because he had this traumatic experience in sports.
Was it traumatic, by the way?
When I met basketball players like him, it got better. In retrospect, it hurt, but I developed a love for sports recreationally and a passion as a fan. The Gators, my dad was the rabbi in Jacksonville, and the toughest services to lead were in the fall on Saturday mornings. Regulars would clear out.
Right.
So, but I'm a big Gator fan.
Mine is not so glamorous. Basketball in the city, basketball.
You played at Carver.
Carver, and then Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia. But my highlight, unfortunately, we have this one big game with Clark Atlanta University. I still remember the guy's name. His name was Wayne. Wayne was a scorer who scored about 35 to 40 points per game at that time.
Right.
And I have about a 38-inch, 39-inch arm, and so my coach said, you are the defensive guy. You close,
you
shut
You're
Wayne
the stopper.
Down. And so through the first half of the game, Wayne has only scored like 10 points, which was phenomenal.
For Wayne.
I'm done pretty good. I held him in that game to under 15 points. But here's the part that I didn't like. The only time I ever made the newspaper in my career was that Wayne goes by me, I fall down on the floor, and I'm looking up while he goes by and slam dunks the basketball.
You were posterized.
And even though I held him to under 40 points, they have this terrible picture of me ingrained in the newspaper looking up at a guy slamming dunking the basketball. So my career wasn't as glamorous as these two.
No, you tried out for
the
NBA.
That's not the big stuff.
You tried out for the Hawks.
I tried to, and it didn't work. So, that's the big stuff.
So partly what I want to talk about a little bit is, it is interesting. I was just looking at the history of religion and sports in this country. It used to be that religion was against physical exercise, and then the sort of Teddy Roosevelt thing came on, and it became part of the Protestant work ethic to be involved in sports. It feels like now that sports is, and people will talk about as a religion in the South, football is a religion in the South, and they talk about baseball as cathedrals. And when we have a 9/11 service, it was at Yankee Stadium. Scott, what is the role? Is sports now a quasi-religion, or is that demeaning to religion? Where do you see them fitting? How does sports fit?
Yeah. Well, I mean, religion has to do with not necessarily what you believe. It has to do with your rituals and what you do to bring about some meaning in your life. I absolutely think religion has the capacity. I mean, sports has the capacity to be a religion, and many, many people do practice it. Now, does it ultimately give you meaning in your life? I would say probably not. It is a false religion in that regard, in that it doesn't lead you to things of ultimate value.
Micah, same question.
The most famous rabbi in 1900, Solomon Schechter, said to be a rabbi in America in 1900, you have to know baseball.
Really?
He said that. Now, I think in 2011, you have to know football, soccer, and basketball, too. I think sports is not only a religion, it's gone to a form of idolatry. And I say that as a sports fan. I mean, let's face it, I devote countless hours to following sports, and we spend billions of dollars watching mostly a bunch of grown men run around with a ball. If you look at it objectively,
right,
without demeaning what
clearly,
gives me
right
personally. So yeah, I think it's not only religion, I think it's a form of idolatry and lately a source of abuse.
So do you, beyond it then acknowledging that, which I acknowledge too, and it's one of the things I wrestle with, do you do anything beyond acknowledge that? I mean, we still pour as much money into the Gators more than ever. The shrines that we build to football are larger and grander than ever. The amount that we spend on a jumbo screen compared to the amount that we spend on feeding the it's staggering. Is there anything to do other than to note that and yet then head off to the game merrily and get some popcorn?
Well, I don't think we elevate other things, like the U of M's business school going from disaccreditation 10 years ago to top 25% in the country. I just learned yesterday that for all we hear about UT and the medical school here having its issues, and Scott would know the most about this, the physiology department was ranked number 2 in the country in terms of grants. Now, how come I've lived here 20 years and I didn't know that? I heard about all the bad. But there's this distinguished professor who told me this yesterday, and he said, oh, we know about it within the physiology world. But as a Memphian, I never knew that.
Is that, though, and I want to just not challenge you on that a little bit, but is that not just a version of the, if you had to have bake sales to build bombers? Yes, it's too bad that teachers make this and ball players make this, and that we spend so much money on defense instead of. But it doesn't sort of. Is there anything we still care about movies more than we care about the physiology department? Is that just the way of the world?
I care more about. Well, all I'm saying is there's sizzle.
As a society.
Well, there's sizzle there. I believe universities survive by grants, and if Memphis is number 2 in the country in terms of grants in physiology, and that's the sizzle of academia, why not raise it up?
Right.
That's all.
Keith, what's your thought on all of it?
My thought on all of it is very similar. Idolatry, I think, is a very good word. As I look even at the NBA right now, and I look at people arguing over billions of dollars, but yet we can't figure out how to get health care to those who need it the most, and then how to feed those who are homeless, especially at a time of year when I'm going to try to serve people and we're going to try to figure out how to really get a hot meal on the table, and guys refuse to go to work to draw their million-dollar paychecks. I do think it's elevated to the level of idolatry, and we've become very desensitized to the reality of the world. We can spend as much on one family outing at a sporting event as we would in social activity or donations for an entire year to Church Health Center or to our synagogue or to our church. So we really have to get some sense of reality and pull this thing back into the lanes.
How do you do that? In other words, does it affect the way you watch sports? Has it changed? We can all note that it is out of control, that LeBron James shouldn't matter to us as much as LeBron James seems to matter to us, that it's insane to spend $6 million on Houston Nutt, the Ole Miss coach, to go away. They paid him $6 million so they can pay the next guy $20 million, and that this is immoral at some level and insane. And yet, what changes? Has it affected the way you watch or care about the NFL? Do you care about the Steelers and the Lakers any less?
It affects the way I teach my family. It affects the way that I talk to young men in my congregation. We lift up sports, especially in the religious sector and through church, as an opportunity, especially for my community, to reach out to young people and to help to show them character and develop a relationship with them so we can put more meaningful lessons into their lives. But not to...
Do they think it's the way out?
Some think it's the way out, but we don't lift it as the way out. We lift education as the way out. We lift our hard work and opportunity, and in some sense, a true relationship with what we call their spiritual higher being, God, through their church, however we phrase that. But we want to make sure that we're not bringing it to the level of idolatry and the only hope that they have.
Was sports for you in a way? In a sense, you are a perfect example of that. You use sports to get to Morehouse,
and I actually used academics.
Much better.
Sports was one of those things that I picked up along the way. People kept telling me I was tall, I should play sports, and that was one of the things that I often would say a little smart aleck answer towards. People would ask me, "So you play on the basketball team?" And I say, "No, I'm the captain of the chess team," because I felt like people looked at me because I was a tall, scrawny African American kid, and they figured all you can do is play sports. But I would often, shoot back at them, "No, I'm the captain of the chess team at my school."
That's fantastic. Scott, let's put it in the... Is FedEx Forum, and David Waters, who's a friend of all of ours here, and a brilliant writer at the Commercial Appeal, and an extraordinary sports fan, he decided that it was immoral to spend the money that we spent on FedEx Forum on FedEx Forum. So he would write columns saying, "Let's not do this." I would write columns saying, "Let's do this." Not because it's... whatever. Is building a $250 million arena with public money, however, is that immoral in the center of Memphis when we have the pyramid?
I mean, war is immoral, and we spend a gazillion dollars on war. So you have to, everything's all relative here. To me, what we have to keep in perspective is, you know, what are the things that make Memphis great? Now, I'm a huge fan of the Tigers. I would do almost anything Josh Pastner asked me to do. But he would agree with me that even if the Tigers win the national championship this year, that will not make Memphis great. You know, what will make Memphis great is how we take care of the least among us. And right now, we're not doing a very good job on that.
Is it immoral that Josh Pastner, again, who we all love, makes $1.7 million or whatever? Is that immoral?
I mean, money in and of itself is not an issue of morality. You know, how we view each other, how we care for each other, how we exhibit love, how we distribute that love, how we determine what is ultimately of the greatest value. That to me is where morality lies. If we think the Tigers winning is the most important thing in Memphis, that is wrong.
And I'll ask this, Micah, to follow up on that though, isn't where we put our money in some ways an indication of what we value?
Absolutely, but I think it's complicated, Geoff. I just was reminded that I was part of a quiet group called Clergy for Grizzlies. We didn't go public. But Frank Thomas, one of the other leading pastors in the city of Mississippi Boulevard Christian Church, he and I had lunch before the Grizzlies came here. And he said to me, do you know what most young African-American professionals associate with Memphis outside of this city? And he's from Chicago. And I said, what? He said, one word, death. The death of King and the death of Elvis. And those who said that the Grizzlies were a waste of money because of the subtle racism in the city, that African Americans wouldn't come to the NBA game because look at the Redbirds,
right,
as if baseball is a predominantly African American spectator,
right,
sport. And
right,
first of all, the assumption, the presumption that anyone not of color should dictate what the, anyway, the NBA is one of the most integrated,
right,
audiences, even more so than some of the Tiger booster seats,
right,
which have of course black athletes, but
right,
In the lower bowl, it's not nearly as integrated.
It's not nearly as diverse as a Grizzlies tie.
But with the money issue, you triggered the thought, Geoff. I wanted to ask Pastor Norman, while you went to Morehouse for education, with this NBA strike, does the rank and file member of your church think of the NBA in terms of this 1.7 million or 6 million, they're not coal miners on strike.
Mm-hmm.
But Joe Jackson seems to matter probably as much as an icon from White Station, mm-hmm, as saying, go to college. Still, there's a veneration of the athlete. You agreed with the idolatry. So what about that disjunct between the message within our synagogues and churches of education and yet the $6 million athlete is still the bomb, right?
In some sense, but I think, again, from a community perspective, and surely I can't speak for the entire African-American community, but there's a hope, there is a freeing, there's an opportunity. And if this is the particular channel that is available to that person, Joe Jackson or others, we want to encourage them to take that channel, but not for every person to believe this is the only channel.
Well, and not only that, it's not even the most... If you were as a four-year-old kid,
right,
to decide what's your best way to get to Morehouse,
right,
the chess team is a much safer way to go,
yeah,
and because you're probably not going to be 6'8", you're probably not going to be able to,
right,
dunk, you're probably... The money that's available, I think there's a myth that all this money is available,
yeah,
for athletes. It is available.
If someone had told me, I would have played golf first because golf was the best way to get there because they had,
right,
an outstanding golf team. But I want to go back to something,
yeah,
I believe that was important that you spoke of. When does it become immoral when you build a FedEx Forum or when you offer Houston Nuts $6 million to leave? I think it's when you turn your head to the other things. I don't think any form of success or any form of progress, because these things can also be used as generators to create income for the poor. One of the things that I saw in Atlanta where the Georgia Dome was built was a government that insisted on building the Georgia Dome right in the heart of one of the most depressed communities communities around so that people who did not have transportation could have easy access to good paying jobs. And so it was a good use of public funds to make this facility come about, where all of this money is being spent in this community, and this community is being transformed by the presence of that arena. And so there are some good situations where you can use public funds to build arenas, but city officials and others who are involved have to really have a commitment to doing what's right in those areas and not overlooking the poverty that tends to surround some of those areas and making sure that we reinvest in those
areas. It's not like there's not enough money.
Right.
There is enough money. I mean, even in Memphis, the poorest major city in America, we got enough money.
Right.
You know, how we use that money, how we distribute it.
I don't think that Memphis was uniquely kind to its poor because it didn't have an NBA team.
That's right.
There are plenty of, you can do both, and not only that. I think the feeling that we had last spring, I think it lifts up a city. I don't know how lasting or meaningful it is. How lasting or meaningful was that, waving a towel above your head and feeling good about the Grizzlies?
It seems like ancient history now, doesn't it?
Yeah. It does. It does.
And yet the poor are still with
us. That's
this issue of ultimate. Ultimate. It was not ultimate. It was a great moment. I loved it. It was fantastic being there. It did not fulfill me in my heart and in my soul. You know, and that's the part about religion, about sports as a religion being an idol. You know, what we advocate is a different way. You know, there is more to life than just things that are ephemeral.
And yet, how one we of your care prized each possession is a Dale Murphy baseball.
I do love my Dale Murphy baseball.
it's okay to be both.
Yeah, I mean, how can you not be for a guy who used to be the spokesperson for milk? I mean, you know, yeah, love it. But it's a fun thing. And if it were to disappear tomorrow, I would be disappointed. And I would go to work tomorrow at the Church Health Center doing what we could to care for the poor of this community. That's what ultimately gives me
meaning. I got about 2 minutes. Let's go, Keith.
Sports is entertainment. And that's what it was created for. Sports is meant to be an outlet for the working family, for the man and the woman who want to take their kids to something wholesome, to a park, to enjoy outdoors and green and all of that wonderful stuff, and indoors for the appropriate sports and the arenas that are played in. But it was never meant to be an idolatrous thing that it has become. Money has been pumped into sports at such a level now that, you know, we compromise values, we overlook things that we should not overlook. From the Pee Wee League all the way to the professional leagues, we start recruiting kids, we start, you know, trying to move a kid from one community to another community because we want him on a certain team to make this team better, to get more money. There's something intrinsically wrong, and I think it's because we've moved away from what it is. Sports is entertainment, and that's all it's
give me the last word.
I disagree with those who say the Penn State scandal isn't a sports story. Everyone was talking about that moment of the prayer in the middle of the field as so heartwarming, and that's
the nexus. It felt like industrialized prayer in the same way that football in the way it had been industrialized.
Well, there's another guy named Morris, not related to this pitcher, who's the quarterback of the Penn State team. His name is Stephen Morris, and he was asked going into the game, coming out of the meeting, what's the message? And he said two words, beat Nebraska, as opposed to assume personal responsibility for the welfare of the innocent. That is the religious message. So I don't care how fervently these guys from different teams came together and prayed. Religion is about assuming personal responsibility for the most vulnerable members of society, and in this case, the innocent. So that's where I think we're abdicating our role as sports fans not to call it what it is.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you very much for your time. We'll be back with a wrap after one question.
What am I thankful for this year? A big turkey.
I am thankful that I have a job where I get to listen to the radio and watch TV all day long.
As a former University of Tennessee Big Orange cheerleader, as a matter of fact, the first one to ever lead Smokey, the blue tick coonhound mascot, into Neyland Stadium, I'm thankful that every freakish, bizarre, Twilight Zone bad break that any coach could ever endure has already happened to Derek Dooley, so the future has to be much better for the Big Orange.
I'm thankful that my husband and I are both vertical and that we have a cute little puppy named Walter. So that's what I'm thankful for. Happy Thanksgiving.
It hasn't been a great stretch in sports, has it? Penn State, the NBA lockout, conference realignment. Wasn't sports supposed to be our escape? So I'm not going to tell you I'm thankful about much in the sports world this Thanksgiving, though Shane Battier hitting that three-pointer was pretty darn great. I'm thankful that people like Scott Morris, Micah Greenstein, and Keith Norman live and work in our community. I'm thankful for the persistent generosity of this city. I'm thankful that I got to meet Dave Bennett this year. He's a former football star at Germantown, Tennessee, who now has ALS. I'm thankful for the life of Larry Finch, who died too young, and for the life of Gene Bartow, who is fighting his illness with customary grace. I'm thankful my kids are healthy and I have a job I love. That's always the essence, isn't it? We get together every week on this television show and we talk about sports. I hope you enjoy the conversations as much as I do. But nobody here confuses sports with the important stuff. I know I certainly don't. That's why maybe the best email I've ever received came from Bennett, the former football player with ALS. I've mentioned it before, and I'll probably mention it again. But this week, Thanksgiving week, it seems especially apt. Bennett had a hard time talking during our interview, but afterwards, his email popped up in my box. "We all have to figure out how to be positive in the midst of a trial," he wrote. "I know this trial has made me a better husband, father, friend, and man. So for that, I am thankful. I have become more patient and understanding, and I have been forced to allow others to have the opportunity to find joy in serving and encouraging me. Life is precious. Nothing is forever. Signed, Dave." If a guy like that can be thankful, maybe the rest of us can be too. Life is precious. Nothing is forever. Until next week, from all of us here at KNO, have a happy Thanksgiving.